So in this video, I'm going to show and explain how the Tesla Powerwall 2 was installed in an outside location. So let's get to it. Hi, John Tisbury here. If this is your first time here and you want to learn more about photography and cinema photography, working with models both on location and in a studio, then start now by subscribing and clicking the bell notification icon to be notified of new updates. I also do videos on my PV solar installation and Tesla Powerwall 2, but you probably knew that because you'd already clicked the link for this particular video. So what I wanted to do on this particular video was take you through our Tesla Powerwall 2 installation, because we had our installation done in an outside location. And this is perhaps slightly different from all of the other installations that I've seen. Generally, most of them have gone for an indoor location, so be that in a garage or in the house or a utility room or somewhere like that. And we didn't have that option, so we went with an outdoor location. So I just wanted to spend some time and talk you through that. So before I go on, it's probably worth giving you some context. We're based in the UK, in the East Midlands. We have a Tesla Powerwall 2, which is installed on the 4th of December 2018. And that was added to our existing solar panels, our PV installation, which was done in September 2011. And that's a 4 kilowatt array with a Sunny Boy inverter, which is a 3.8 kilowatt inverter. So if you were considering getting a Tesla Powerwall 2 installed and you didn't have any room inside to install it, or in the garage or utility room or whatever, don't be worried about that, because outside is absolutely fine. And let me reassure you that you know that is the case. And it's not just me saying that. If you look at the Tesla website, now there are some caveats around the location, and I had a look through the safety instruction manual that comes with the Tesla, and that points out some areas for consideration in terms of the environmental aspect, and I'm going to read them to you. I'll bring them up on screen as well. So on page 4 of the manual, install in a location that prevents damage from flooding. We're okay. Do not expose the power wall to ambient temperatures above 60 degrees C or below minus 30 degrees C. That's 140 to minus 22 Fahrenheit. And ensure no water sources above or near the power wall, including downspouts, sprinklers or faucets, overflows, that kind of thing for the UK. Ensure snow does not accumulate around the power wall. So yeah, all good in the hood there from that perspective. I guess the only thing we need to worry about is where ours is located, is perhaps when it's snowing, is a build-up of snow around the power wall, base of the power wall. But as we get snow very infrequently, it's not really a major concern. But as you'll see in a minute when we have a look at the location, it's potentially something to be aware of. The company we use to supply and fit our Tesla Powerwall was a company called Joju Solar. I'll put their details down in the description below. I'm not on any commission or referral, it's just sort of, if you're interested, that's who we used. And before you sign anything or pay any money, they came out and did a site survey just to understand the lie of the land and whether it was a standard installation or whether it was a sort of bespoke non-standard installation. And what I mean by that is things like cable runs and how far the power wall is away from the consumer unit. Ours was all a standard installation, but for instance, you know, if you wanted the power wall at the back of the house and your consumer unit was right at the front of the house, that may be considered as a non-standard installation because of the length of the cable run. I'd be interested to know about standard and non-standard installations. So if you have had yours installed or about to have yours installed, and it is a sort of non-standard installation, then drop your points and comments and information about the installation down below, and we can sort of help each other and learn from what's a standard and a non-standard installation in terms of a configuration and distances and those kind of things. I guess it's probably different for each type of company, but at least it will give us a flavour and something to evaluate. We've got our power wall fitted against the wall here. This is the wall of our office, so it's a single story wall, and up above we've got a roof with an overhang. And because we're between the two houses here, us and our neighbours, this is fairly sheltered. Apart from the fact the wind whistles down here a bit, it is sheltered from rain and the elements, so we don't need to worry too much about anything like that. And the cat's just coming to see me. So I said that we're fairly sheltered here where we've got this located. The only thing we have noticed is when it's been really cold overnight, so where we've had a sort of a minus or 0 degrees overnight, and then in the morning when the solar panels kick in and start generating electricity, have noticed that the power wall sort of throttles back on how much electricity it can absorb. So it tends to sort of slow down a bit until it's warmed up, and then it'll throttle into normal speed. So that's the only minor thing that we've spotted. It's not a massive curve in terms of what it throttles back on, but it is noticeable compared to a normal day where it, as soon as the solar starts generating at the start of a solar day, it'll take that power straight away. So let's have a look at some of the cables and the installation on our setup. So this particular cable here is our network cable, our LAN cable. You can have a choice of having a Wi-Fi connection to the power wall, or you can go with a hardwired LAN cable, as this is our office through here, and on the other side of this wall is our network switch and our modem and router. I decided to go with a wired connection, which is that one, and this other cable here, it goes to my photography studio, so you can ignore that one. The other cable up here is the in and out to the power wall, an isolator up here, which we can use if need be to turn off the power wall, and that runs down all the way along under the slate there through that little channel, and then back up here and into our electricity cupboard, which I shall show you inside up in a second. So this cable is from the Tesla gateway and houses the cables that have the CT clamps on, the current transformer clamps. These measure the direction, the amount of current flow. A bit tricky to see here, but there are two, one for the Zappy charger and one for the Tesla. There's the new consumer unit, which has three MCBs in them to turn off items. As you'll see there, there's one for the gateway, one for the Tesla, and one for the Zappy. Here's our Tesla gateway. Inside here's all the circuitry that works out where the power goes to and from. It's not a pretty sight inside here. However, you may need to open it up to note down the details of the gateway IDs if you've not been told them by your installer when they configured the installation. Apart from that, probably no real need to go into it. There are actually two Wi-Fi networks, which you'll see broadcasting if you have a look at your computer or your smartphone. On the door on the left-hand side is the Neurio module. The power wall uses an energy monitoring system manufactured by them, and this is the Wi-Fi network that it uses. The second Wi-Fi network is the Tesla gateway, which you connect to if you want to monitor performance via an internet browser. rather than you using the Tesla app on your smartphone. It will broadcast TEG, TE short for Tesla, G short for Gateway, followed by a unique ID for your system. This can be found in a couple of places within this box, on the door, and there's a sticker, and also on the back panel. I've actually blurred mine out so you can't read them, but they are there. If you choose to go the hardwired route for your network connection, then you don't need to worry about these Wi-Fi networks, but it's useful to know what they are anyway. So this is our Zappy charger. Again, this has a cable running to it, and also a feed into a connector, so it can monitor how much is being delivered. At the moment, I haven't actually used this, so I haven't got a car at the moment that will take it. So I was waiting for our car to arrive so we can actually use that. So that's it for me. So I hope you found that useful and can now consider a Tesla at an outside location. If you found the video useful, then do give it a thumbs up or thumbs down. And remember to subscribe, hit that notification bell icon so you can be notified of new updates. And I'll see you on the next one. All right, take care. Bye.